It began as a humble display overseen by local enthusiast Milton Malberg. Then in 1942, it became the nucleus for a new museum and moved into this Victorian mansion. And still, Malberg kept adding items and building displays. Hello, I'm Jim Wilhelm. Eventually, the Burpee Museum of Natural History filled every nook and cranny of this building. And what was once the grandest home in Rockford was now cluttered with the remnants of its geological past. The house itself had been built in 1893 by a local industrialist at a cost of over $30,000. Inside, hand-carved cherry woodwork adorned the foyer and main hallway. Yet despite its 15 rooms, there was not enough space. Eventually, the museum acquired this house next door. It had been the home of another local industrialist, John Manny. His company manufactured reapers based on a design his father had invented and patented in 1849. The McCormick Company sued him for patent infringement, and the case eventually wound up before the Supreme Court. There, Manny's lawyer successfully defended his machine. Oh, and one of the lawyers at the time, Abraham Lincoln. Anyway, back to the Burpee Museum. Recently, a new addition was added to the Manny Mansion, and the collection moved again. What Malberg had begun in the 1920s has now blossomed into a first-rate facility. Inside are several dioramas that visitors can walk through, taking them on a trip through the geological and biological history of northern Illinois. This one represents the Rockford area of about 200 million years ago, when it was a tropical rainforest. At that time, the most dominant plants were the lycopod trees that could reach heights of over 100 feet. Today, lycopods are represented by only a handful of club mosses. But back then, they were the beginning of Illinois' energy reserve. As the plants died and fell into stagnant waters, a thick mat of plant material accumulated. Those mats were then covered over with mud and sand, and the process repeated itself. As the levels built up, the plants below came under increased pressure and heat. That plant material slowly changed into coal. Today, coal underlies 65% of the state, and of the 75 seams that have been identified, only 20 have been mined commercially. Illinois still has the largest reserve of bituminous coal in the nation. Rising above me is the most popular exhibit. It's one of only two T-Rex skeletons on display anywhere in the Midwest. These are not the actual bones, but casts of the bones from the T-Rex that stands in the American Museum of Natural History in New York. It was the first such skeleton ever seen by the public and was created from the remains of two different T-Rexes. Both fossils were found in the early 1900s by the famous paleontologist Barnum Brown at the Hell Creek Formation in Montana. To date, only about 30 T-Rex skeletons have been found, and none of them were completely intact. This one is 35 feet long and stands 10 feet high. A living T-Rex might weigh as much as 8 tons. Another carnivore, but on a different scale, is the one moviegoers will recognize by the scythe-shaped claws on its feet. This is a cast of the Raptor Dromaeosaurus, discovered by scientists in 1922 in Alberta, Canada. They were a vicious predator whose claws could rip apart their prey. Interestingly, dinosaur fossils have never been found in Illinois. Fossils are formed in low, wet areas where the sediments bury the remains, and Illinois was at that time a high land area. Plus, during the Ice Age, glaciers scraped away the top layers of rock, destroying any possible evidence of local dinosaurs. And speaking of the Ice Age, this was one of the creatures roaming through Illinois during that era, which was from 35,000 to 12,000 years ago. This is a skeleton of a Columbian mammoth. It's a larger cousin of the woolly mammoth, and it too had a thick coat of hair to protect it from the cold. Some people speculate that their size contributed to the beginning of human communities. They were too big for one person to fell, so families came together and villages were organized to hunt these beasts. Above the fossil displays is an area being converted to showcase the mineral collection and learn more about Illinois' geological history. Soon this floor will be filled with interactive displays exploring, among other things, the ice ages and plate tectonics. In addition to the exhibits, visitors can watch and talk to scientists as they work in the labs. Behind me, a paleontologist is busy categorizing and preserving bones. Recently, the museum has been sponsoring a dig in the Hell Creek Formation of Montana, just about the same area where the T-Rex skeleton on display was found. In addition to staff, a limited number of the public are allowed on location. This is a bone that was discovered during the last outing. It's from the leg of a juvenile triceratops. Everything found on those trips is sent back here and added to the collection, which has never stopped growing. Bones shipped from the field are covered in burlap and plaster for protection. To harden the fragile pieces, a solution of acetate and plastic is used. The acetate soaks into the bone and evaporates, leaving the plastic to harden. This piece is from a find which has created quite a stir. It's a toe bone from a 20-foot theropod, which is a dinosaur that walks on three toes, and it's very unusual. But this skeleton appears to have been preserved in its life position, which is very rare. Eventually, this piece might be a small part of a new exhibit. In addition to ancient animals, the museum also gathers examples of today's wildlife for its biological collection. Any of the animals or birds currently being added to the collection have been found dead in the wilds. In the storeroom are rows of mounted birds and animals waiting to be placed in exhibits or for use in a classroom. Plus, there's an extensive assortment of butterflies and insects. But the real treasure down here is not generally seen by the public. In drawer after drawer are study skins, which are not mounted or posed for display, but are a historical record. They not only chronicle the species that lived in this area, but also any changes or adaptations that occurred in the population. Researchers studying a particular species could handle the skins, take measurements, and study the coloring. And they'll last practically forever. Imagine 100 years from now, scientists could still be examining these skins. But it's not just animals. Also stored away is a collection that was gathered during the 1940s representing the plant life found in this area. Many of these were taken from parts of Rockford, now heavily developed. The third floor contains artifacts and exhibits relative to the first people to live in this area, as well as the landscape they faced. Soon the biological collection will be used to enhance several walk-through dioramas that will recreate various ecosystems, from wetlands to prairies. In addition to all these exhibits, the museum also offers a large variety of programs. For example, there are classes for both teachers and students, guest lectures, fossil hunts, and other special events. And then there's the ever-popular overnight stay where the kids bunk in this wigwam and listen to tales told by Native American storytellers. What began as a small collection that crept into every corner of an old Victorian mansion has now become a first-rate facility. But it doesn't stand alone. The Burpee is connected by an underground tunnel to Rockford's Riverfront Museum Complex, which consists of the Art Museum and the Children's Discovery Center. For more information about programs offered at the Burpee Museum of Natural History, log on to their website at www.burpee.org, or they can be reached by phone at 815-965-3433.